Tonight, Android Lollipop is released into the wild. Are you ready for HD smartphone calls? And unlock your hotel door with an iPhone. Tech News Tonight is next.
This is Twit.
This is Tech News Tonight, episode 207 for Monday, November 3rd, 2014. This episode is brought to you by NatureBox. NatureBox ships great tasting snacks right to your door. Start snacking smarter with wholesome, delicious treats like jalapeno cashews. To get your complimentary NatureBox sampler, visit naturebox.com/twit. That's naturebox.com/twit. Hello, everybody. Happy Monday. I'm Sarah Lane, and let's get right into today's tech feed. Well, it's cats and dogs living together because the U.S.'s two biggest wireless providers, Verizon and AT&T, say that they're going to work together to reach VoLTE or Voice over LTE interoperability sometime next year. In other words, HD calls for all, or for, you know, many, because they cover a lot of the nation. HD Voice will route calls over each carrier's 4G LTE technology to achieve clearer, better conversations. You know, for those of you who still like talking on the phone, whoever you are, although video calling and richer messaging are also part of the longer-term plans. Now, only certain phones support VoLTE features right now. Am I even saying that right? That's such a VoLTE. All right. On Verizon, Verizon has already rolled out VoLTE nationwide on the iPhone 6, 6 Plus, Samsung Galaxy S5, and LG's G2. Both carriers, though, say that they hope to offer similar interoperability with other U.S. providers in the future. Interoperability. I like that word. Starwood Hotels has officially launched its SPG keyless service at its Aloft, Element, and W hotels, which let guests use their iOS device and soon an Apple Watch to unlock hotel doors and bypass the front desk altogether. Now, after opting in during the reservation process, approximately 24 hours before arrival, a guest will receive their room number and a Bluetooth key via the app. Then, when they're at the hotel, the guest opens the SPG app, taps the device on the door lock, and then waits for the green light and then enters the room. Simple as that, or in theory anyway. There's always a physical key backup option, of course. If your iPhone battery dies, you're not going to get into your room. Meanwhile, Hilton Worldwide has announced that it will be introducing its own smartphone key system, a similar one, in the spring at four of its brands: U.S. Hilton Hotels and Resorts, Waldorf Astoria Hotels and Resorts, Conrad Hotels and Resorts, and Canopy by Hilton Properties. U.S. only at first, at least at first. Both Starwood and Hilton also say they will support Android handsets. Yay! In other Apple news, the company, which owns Beats Music, announced a partnership with Southwest Airlines to deliver its streaming library to in-flight entertainment on board any Southwest plane that offers Wi-Fi. So Southwest customers will be able to access Beats Music for free if they have a device compatible with the Beats app, which includes iOS and Android. And it can also work with any web browser that works with the browser-based Beats streaming site. So it's a good opportunity to at least try it out if you're going to be sitting on a plane anyway for free. Samsung announced today that its unique Galaxy Note Edge smartphone that kind of has that one side that sort of falls off will launch in the U.S. on November 14th on AT&T, on Sprint, on T-Mobile, on Verizon, and U.S. Cellular. And will also be sold at Samsung Experience shops at Best Buy. Samsung didn't share specific pricing or availability for each carrier, although AT&T says the device will sell for $400 with a two-year agreement or no annual commitment for a whopping $946. Yikes. The Galaxy Note Edge is already available in South Korea and Japan, and Samsung confirmed earlier that it will arrive in the U.S., China, Australia, Russia, and India by the end of this year. Texas-based online vacation rental company HomeAway is suing the city of San Francisco to overturn a new law legalizing short-term rentals that it says favors rival Airbnb over its own business. Airbnb is based in San Francisco, which is sort of part of the issue. HomeAway operates VRBO.com and bedandbreakfast.com and alleges in a complaint that was filed today in federal court that an ordinance that was approved by San Francisco city supervisors that Airbnb was also involved in drafting grants Airbnb a local monopoly over the short-term rental business because it adopts Airbnb's business model. The ordinance allows rentals by permanent city residents only through an agency hosting platform and outlaws any competing business model such as HomeAways that doesn't require listing owners to act as agents in collecting and holding fees and taxes. This, of course, is according to HomeAway. The company also says that the San Francisco law unconstitutionally allows only city residents to rent on a short-term basis, but that there's no evidence that prohibiting non-residents from renting out property has any impact on affordable housing, which is a huge issue in San Francisco. Trust me. Tech publication CNET is expanding into a platform often seen as a little outdated in this day and age. Print. CNET's new quarterly print magazine, also named CNET, is now being sold on newsstands for $5.99 and stores like Costco and Target and Walmart. The magazine's winter 2014 premiere issue is 128 pages long, features LL Cool J, rapper, actor, on the cover. And, this is important, will carry articles of its own rather than just recycling content from CNET.com. So it's its own beast, quarterly beast. One of the two editors-in-chief, Lindsay Turntine, is editor-in-chief of CNET.com and also a regular co-host on Twit's morning news program, Tech News Today. That's how you know it's good. Coming up, sidewalks made with solar panels. How will they charge things? And next, I will chat with Florence Ion from Greenbot about Android Lollipop's official release. But first, we gotta thank NatureBox because NatureBox kept me fed today and I was real grouchy earlier. Right now, NatureBox is giving you a chance to get a complimentary trial box of their most popular snacks and just pay $2 for shipping. The rest of it is completely free. You want to snack smart. If you eat a candy bar, you're gonna have a sugar crash. It's not good for you. Put away the potato chips. You want delicious, wholesome snacks at naturebox.com. Now, this is not just a few snacks to choose from. NatureBox has hundreds of snacks to choose from. And you don't have to feel guilty about snacking during the day because they're better for you. Zero artificial flavors or colors or sweeteners. None of that junk in there. 0 grams trans fat. Trans fat is terrible for you. No high fructose corn syrup in any NatureBox snacks. You also find snacks with no sugar, with no gluten, depending on your dietary needs. So when you're hungry and you need something quick and easy and delicious, go for some apple cinnamon crave from NatureBox or sriracha roasted cashews or cranberry macaroon granola. I could go on. Anyway, there's hundreds of snacks in there and they're better for you. Start your trial today and get a complimentary sample box at naturebox.com/twit. Free food, people, and it's good. Stay full, stay strong. Start stacking smarter at naturebox.com/twit. And thanks to NatureBox for the support of Tech News Tonight. Joining us now is Florence Ion, staff writer over at Greenbot. Hello, Florence.
Hello. How are you today?
Very well. Thanks for being on TN2, your inaugural guest episode.
Absolutely, and hopefully not the last time.
Exactly. No, this is just the beginning of a beautiful friendship. Hey, perfect. So Android 5.0 Lollipop is officially here. We heard about it. Oh, gosh. I mean, beta testers have been playing around with Lollipop for, what, we got a couple weeks now. But it's a really major update. I mean, since Android's debut back in 2008, can you believe it's been that long?
I mean, I can't believe it's been that long because I feel like I've been using it for longer than I have. This is definitely one of Google's most mature versions of Android that I've seen thus far. It really feels like an almost complete piece of work. And it's thus by far my most favorite version of Android.
So you mentioned it feels complete. Is the new look material design, known as material design within the Android team and otherwise, how much does that play into how you feel it's gotten more cohesive?
I would say that's the main reason that I feel it's so cohesive, because now we have all these bold colors and animations working together. The interface really feels interactive now, like you're interacting with it. It's not just, you know, it's not just this blank operating system, which is what Android has felt like for quite some time. You know, it was kind of meant to be a blank slate so that you can, you know, customize it to your liking and kind of tinker around with it. But I feel like now it's finally becoming a little more user-friendly for the everyman, for the every type of techie user.
So you've been playing around with Lollipop, as you mentioned, for a while. I know several apps have been updated as well. I've got a big Gmail update today for Android users, calendar, Google Docs, that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. You know, much like iOS, there are, of course, those native Google apps that are really, really important, although some of them have options on other platforms as well.
Absolutely.
How much have those native apps been given enough TLC to, again, fit into what you're saying is a really big update here?
Everything has been updated just sort of incrementally over the last few months since Google I.O., since Google made the official announcement of what we previously knew as Android L. So it's not really a surprise to see all of the interface updates coming out. I think Gmail and Calendar were the ones left to sort of be like the grand finale of updates. Like, here we go, guys. Everything is complete. Here's the complete material design package. And those are also the two apps that have a lot of cross-platform visibility. So, I think it was just kind of all part of the rollout strategy to just let everybody get used to it bit by bit. And then, you know.
Well, so what about the Android users who say, well, I want 5.0 Lollipop. It is officially released, but which devices is it actually available for at this point? Because that's sometimes a more complicated answer.
Right. It's still, the answer I have for you is also still complicated. Google has said that the Nexus 4, 5, both generations of the 7, and the 10 would get the Lollipop updates. Obviously, if you're using anything before that, where have you been all this time? Because those other devices are really old, which makes sense. HTC just recently, like I think 2 hours ago, just confirmed that they got their build from Google and they're going to start working on bringing Sense to the Lollipop world. I believe Sam Mobile earlier today showed some leak of Samsung's TouchWiz on Lollipop. So we're still kind of getting rollouts. If I'm not mistaken, I think even Sony said something. But if you're not on a stock Google phone or device right now, you're probably going to have to wait a little longer for it to just sort of get optimized and get fit for the phone or tablet you're using right now.
You know, it's always been, as somebody who's primarily on iOS for everything, that's always kind of been my gripe is, you know, it would be so frustrating to be an Android user who's not able to use the most current version of Android. But again, I understand I'm largely preaching to the choir of anyone who's watching or listening to this show. In general, what are the opinions? People like Lollipop? Is anybody saying, material design is, you know, it's too flat. We want the old Android back. Or was it in general pretty happy across the board?
Anecdotally, I would say that I think material design, and this is all from my perspective, is being a little more accepted. And I think it's being a little more accepted than iOS 7 was, for instance. But of course, I'm speaking, you know, from solely like a person who uses Android and is stuck in this Android ecosystem. That said, I don't think that there's much that could be said about it that is negative, because Google sort of released it in this beta mode to developers to sort of help them work out the kinks so that when it was officially released to the end users, it would be, you know, without too many bugs and without, you know, too many things going wrong here and there. So I think interface-wise, this is the best thing that Google's ever done for Android. I think it's also indicative of the fact that Android has had its new leader, Sundar Pichai, and this is his magic working right now. So,
well, sounds like it's working quite well, at least so far. For Florence Ion, staff writer over at Greenbot at greenbot.com. Thanks for joining us, Florence. And before you go, let us know where we can keep up with your work.
Come check out my work at greenbot.com and pcworld.com, which is our sister site. And you can also read me at Twitter at Oh That Flow.
Good Twitter name. We've had some really creative Twitter names lately. Oh That Flow. Thanks, Florence.
Thank you so much.
See you on another episode of TN2 very soon.
Absolutely. Ciao.
Ciao. All right. Finally, the Netherlands recently announced that it's going forward with a bike lane 70 meters long with built-in solar panels. Now, the lane will open on November 12th in Kromenie, which I hope I'm saying right. It's about 25 kilometers outside of Amsterdam. It's made of rectangular concrete blocks. They have layers of solar panels that are encased in 1-inch thick glass, supposedly that can withstand the weight and pressure of a large truck without cracking or breaking or anything. Solar Road is the consortium behind the build-out, says that even a small chunk of road can generate enough electricity to power 3 homes. And realistically can generate enough electricity to also power electric cars and businesses and other power-hungry objects. So not just on top of the sidewalk, but around the sidewalk as well. The Netherlands, the Dutch, they're on top of everything, aren't they? And that is it for this edition of Tech News Tonight. It was a good Monday, everybody. Subscribe to the show at twit.tv/TN2. Write us with feedback at tn2@twit.tv. And watch live every day at 4 p.m. Pacific, 7 p.m. Eastern. Don't miss our morning news program, Tech News Today, tomorrow and every weekday at 10 a.m. Pacific, 1 p.m. Eastern. I'm Sarah Lane. I'll be here same time, same place tomorrow. Thanks for watching.
Bandwidth for Tech News Tonight is brought to you by CashFly.com.